Okay.
Well, we're very glad that you're here today. Today, we're going to plan on going through the instructional models. We'll be looking at STEM best practices. Michael is going to take you on a tour, Dr. Watson. And then at the end, we're going to do another reflection like we did before with what's your takeaway for today. And you have an opportunity to ask a question or make a comment. We're just going to do it on notebook paper, so I will pass that out at the end, and then you just sign it and date it. It's a really informal, kind of quick formative assessment for us. So, are there any things that you would really like to see happen today? I know I said that in my email, but have you got some pressing questions that you want to make sure that we address today?
How do I find money for calculators?
Okay, write that down. We can ask
money for calculators.
Because, especially, I want them to have the same calculators that math is using and for science, just because it's good practice, but it's expensive.
For each teacher to have their own classroom
set?
Yeah,
because I just think that would make sense. Because that's the best thing that ever happened to us, to be able to use calculators on science tests.
Do you know how many years it took of testimony?
I just think it's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous.
Well, let me tell you the history of that. Because I was there, that the science teachers looked at the test and they said, oh no, they can do that math. That's simple. And then, you know, when they couldn't, for different reasons, actually we'll have some discussion about it today, that TEA would not budge. And it took 3 years of us testifying at the state board before they finally, somebody, put the pressure, one of the board members put the pressure.
And like we had contemplated just buying the little whatever, but I'm like, if we're using the the fancy ones in math, we might as well be using it in science too, so that they can practice. Mm-hmm. So
that would make
trying
sense.
To find the money.
Well,
maybe
Patricia, did you see me?
You know.
So here, let me slide this direction so you can be right here.
Okay, so money for calculators.
Okay.
Our ears open.
We just, yeah.
I have
just,
how much is it?
How
much do you need?
I'll have to let you know. I have a quote.
Okay.
Let me look it up.
Okay.
So anybody else have pressing questions?
I know that's what I'm...
That you have today?
PTO. Should we just ask, is there any pressing thing that you want to make sure we talk about today? And if you think of it later on, that's okay too. Okay. So, and then one of the things that Dr. West is going to talk with us about too is what the teachers want to see in their principals. So, I'm going to turn it over to her and let her weave that in. And then throughout that, after that finishes, somewhere in there, I'm going to hand out the latest Enhance and Impede chart that you've seen before. I've added stuff to that again, and we'll continue doing that because that's part of the research. So you'll get an updated copy of that too. So welcome, and thank you, Dr. Watson, Michael, for having us. We really appreciate it. There's also water and snacks over there, so help yourself.
If you want a copy, I can go get you a copy.
He has a Keurig in the front office.
Yeah. I saw that. It was nice.
Yeah. Would you like
how
some?
Uptown is that?
Wow. Okay. So.
Thanks,
okay.
PTA.
Okay.
Okay, we had some discussions last time about instructional models. And the idea, I think, comes from how complex instruction really is, or effective instruction really is. And so these graphics are supposed to convey that. I don't know if they do, but that was the idea, that it is very complex. So where do we begin? Well, I think we always have to begin with classroom observations. So I am in, as you know, a lot of classrooms, a lot of districts. Each semester it changes because I have student teachers. This semester I have a student teacher in Alamo Heights. I have San Antonio. I have one in Round Rock, one in Pflugerville, two in Hayes, Lehman and Choppa. And one in San Marcos
oh, wow.
this semester.
It is amazing.
I am. I put about 1,500 miles on my car each semester with student teachers. And so I'm observing the cooperating teacher instruction initially, so I can translate that to the to my student teachers. And of course, it's easier for me to get into the their observations because I have a history with them. I had 100 hours in the science methods course with them, plus field trips before they went into student teaching. And we meet monthly seminar for monthly seminars. We have one this Friday. And when I go out to make a classroom observation, I go in before the class initially, get all the handouts and of everything, and a little bit of background. But I keep up with them pretty well, so I know pretty well where they are, the teaks, etc. And then as I am observing, I write comments on all of the handouts. I don't do a narrative, perhaps like you do. I used to do that, but I find I can get better feedback if I'm making specific comments on their lesson parts. And then I spend an hour debriefing with them in terms of feedback, because we're talking about teachers wanting feedback. And then I have gone to a second observation now, so I'll stay a third hour in there with them and look at the lesson to see how it's been changed, and then do another debriefing with the student teacher to help them think about general best practices as well as STEM best practices. And if there is if there are students who are not learning, too many students who are not learning, what best practices are missing? So that's, to me, that's what classroom observations tell me. If it's not effective in any area, I'm going back to best practices and doing a checklist and saying, okay, what's missing here? And so it's not, and it's easy for me to have the conversation with a student teacher because we've already had 100 plus hours together, and they trust me because they know that it's pass-fail and they're all going into their student teaching with very good preparation. They already know how to plan lessons. We did that a lot in on the course and all. So I think what I miss are the fundamentals. So I don't know if you like this story or not, but Vince Lombardi was having a problem with winning, and so he started back with the fundamentals with, these are professional football players. This is a football. And so what he did, every day during training, he went back through all the fundamentals. And after that, he never lost in the playoffs again. He had 5 national championships out of 7 years, and he never coached a team with a losing record. That's pretty good. Again, it's because of the fundamentals. I don't know if you know about John Wooden, the basketball coach. Same thing. He taught players how to correctly put on their socks. I mean, he really went back to the fundamentals. And how to tie their shoes. So, where would I start then? First of all, I start with the content. In fact, when Michael and I were talking about interviewing, I said in my mind, if I'm hiring a science or math teacher, the first thing I'm going to do is look at their transcript. I'm going to see, do they have that content background? Because nothing else matters if you don't have the content. Nothing. So, I would identify the teaks when we go in. I know the teaks pretty well. I don't know them verbatim, but I have a pretty good sense of it. Excuse me. In fact, when I go into even observing in your teachers in your classrooms, and I try to put student teachers in your classrooms because I want them to have a good background and have a good experience. So I like putting student teachers in my mixed teachers classrooms. So the first thing they have to do is clearly understand the teaks. Oftentimes teachers do not understand the teaks, so they can't teach to them if they don't understand it. Well, in my mind, I think we understand the science teaks by looking at all of the national standards. So there are 4 national standards that my student teachers have to put in their lesson plans. You would not believe the lesson plans that I require them to prepare. But I give them time to prepare, that they do not teach a full day. And they need to go back and understand what do our national standards say about that particular TEKS. And they identify from those standards content understanding. If they don't understand that content, they can learn it from our national standards. They also can learn what are the cognitive appropriateness levels. We have what we call in-band grade point, in-band grades. So that it says by the end of fourth grade, they should understand this. In middle school, it's typical by the end of eighth grade, and then high school by the end of 12th grade that they should understand this. So it tells what they should and should not teach. And it has a way of saying that's very clear in terms of, we call them assessment boundaries that are in this NGSS. The framework, a framework for K-12 science education and the next generation science standards, NGSS, are twins. This was the one that was created in 2011, and then the next generation science standards were based on that. And so they're not separate documents. You have to use them together. they can also get language, because oftentimes when I'm going into science classroom, I see a vagueness of language. We talk in mix about sloppy language. So it could be sloppy in general, where there are a lot of pronouns used, and you know, this and that, and over here or there, you know, kind of a generalization instead of the specificity, and it also the precision in language and science. So that I'm not saying you should give definitions, but what I'm saying is, if you're explaining a concept, you're going to give the, if you would, the whole definition. Not just parts of it that end up misleading students. So that precision of language can play out in general terms as well as content specificity. It also gives examples and labs and activities that teachers can use to teach those specific contents, which is kind of funny because a lot of them are the same ones, you know, we've used for 30 years and they're still good ones. It's just like C-scope activities. Those were just rewrites of many of the labs that we did for years. And also, we need to look at the vertical alignment both below and above the TEKS. What is the difference between buoyancy in fourth grade versus relative density in fifth grade, for example? There is a difference. They're not the same thing. One's a force. Buoyancy is a force. Relative density is where you're comparing the density of one substance to another relative to something else. And then the horizontal between math and ELA. We know there are problems in sixth grade and eighth grade. We know there are problems with that, which we have identified. TEKS resource system has not fixed that. Mm-hmm. They still have the math being used in sixth grade with calculating density in, I'll say September, but early, versus in math, they don't get to that skill until November. So I have recommended to administrators, let your teachers have some flexibility in that scope and sequence, because science and math people at TEKS resource system are not talking to each other, and they haven't fixed that, and they should know about it because we've talked about it for a couple of years. So that horizontal alignment is critical. There's also some horizontal issues with processes such as graphing, you know, et cetera, at the grade levels that we have not identified specifically like we have with the content. The content, you know, was easier to do so. So identifying the learning objectives with the TEKS, you know, what is it? Is it a concept? Is it a process skill? Or is it both within that TEKS? Most often it is both a concept and a process skill within the TEKS. So what does that mean in terms of where you start with your lesson instruction? Well, you're going to start, as I said, what is the learning objective? If it's a concept, then generally we use some form of inquiry. It doesn't have to be 5E. There are other forms of inquiry. And there are also 6Es and 7Es. So don't get stuck on 5. And it's not marched through the Es. It can be two explorations instead of one. It can be two explanations or two elaborations, so it's not that rigid. I worked with the biological science curriculum study when they were developing this back in the early 1990s. And they have new materials out. And if you look at even the table of contents for their materials, you can see it is not marked through the T's. You guys can have all these. You can have this PowerPoint if you need it. We can put it on our Weebly site. Okay, so if it's not a concept then, if it's a process of completing a chart or some kind of skill or how to use a piece of equipment, you need to use direct instruction. So that's where you start with initially. What is the learning objective? And that tells you what kind of instructional model that you're going to use for that particular learning objective. So the idea is that, are we going to use an inductive model or are we going to use a deductive model? An inductive model, we're going to start with the separate examples, and that's going to lead us to a general idea, a principle, a pattern that's going to be discovered by the student through these. This would be the inquiry model, which is inductive. And this is going to be, of course, the direct instructional model. So the principle or pattern is going to be presented or taught by the teacher, and then they're going to practice it with either cookbook labs, you know, which we've had in science for so long. And I'm happy to say that the universities are trying to move away from that. They've done a better job in physics. It started in physics, which is kind of interesting. So, to understand models of instruction, and I think many of our teachers do not understand that. So if you want to think about going back to fundamentals, this might be something that they might, you might want to approach and then let them have some planning time to see, therefore, what does that mean with their discipline. So the idea, the complexity here is that you have this 5E, theoretical 5E, but you might need direct instruction in any of these components if it's a process that the students are going to use, if it's a chart they're going to complete, if it's a piece of equipment that they're going to need to use. I was in a seventh grade classroom 2 weeks ago, and they were doing the typical cell lab, you know, where they're looking, using the microscopes. And the problem was that they had not developed the process, and they had not taught the students how to use a microscope. Now, this is seventh grade. They're supposed to have used binocular scopes in elementary, although I probably don't see that happening. Those are about $300 a piece. But they should have had that experience. But I tell my students, assume they know nothing, like Colonel Klinger. So you always go back and you teach that skill. You don't assume that they know how to do it. And it can occur in any of these phases. So you've got this, again, it's not this simple, it's more complicated than that, in that it, you know, it can flow into any or all of those phases of a 5E, if you would. So the next thing that we have to look at after we look at the instructional model is what kind of strategies, and typically that's where teachers start. In fact, in science, I don't know if it's true in other disciplines, they always start with the, you know, what activity am I going to do with this? Instead of starting with, what's my learning objective, and therefore, what instructional model should I choose, and what activities best fit within this instructional model? So there are general best practices. We've had some pretty good instruction in MIX about using the Bloom, Hess, Costa levels, and I think you have a copy of that. Does this ring a bell with you? Mm-hmm. Okay. And Michael, this kind of goes back to what you were saying about going into that classroom about the level of the verb. And I've told y'all this, when we wrote the science teaks, we didn't pay any attention to verbs. We didn't have time to. We were looking at content. So I think those national standards give a lot of guidance about what level of verbs are appropriate, cognitively appropriate for each grade level. The idea of choosing active learning strategies, general things like questioning that are, you know, in every discipline. But then there are these STEM-specific ones. for example, this concrete pictorial representational abstract, this is the newer version, and you know it by the date on the bottom. Remember I told y'all to be sure and look at dates on the bottoms? So, Alright, so here's the latest version, which was September 17th. There are a little, some changes in there. So you have the concrete pictorial representational, and the idea that in general, not every lesson, but in general, in science and math, it needs to start with a concrete experience. Now, concrete experience can play out in a lot of different ways. It can be hands-on. Now, hands-on does not mean inquiry. There are science teachers who will say, we do a lot of hands-on. Well, that's true, you should, because it's concrete, but it's not inquiry. That is not an investigation, just because they tell you they're doing hands-on. So the examples that we've given here are both in math and science. So I'll give you a moment to read through those if you'd like.
They were using the tiles to as concrete. Mm-hmm. And the next day, they were doing pictorials.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was the next week. And
mm-hmm.
then
mm-hmm.
so she was going through the process. So that was
absolutely
pretty good.
That's,
and then.
Yes, perfect. Now, there's a little bit of difference between math pictorial representational and science pictorial representational. So they consider pictorial representational where after they using the math manipulatives, then they're drawing that out, what
right.
that looks like representational or pictorially, versus, and then the next step would be where they're actually using the numerical, the numbers with it.
However, here's my question,
mm-hmm.
and this is something that some of the students already knew how to do this.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but they didn't understand the math conceptually.
They may not. So that's why I was asking Mary Lou, is like, how do you differentiate at this point then? And she did a little bit when they started doing the pictorial. If they're struggling with the pictorial, all right, get the tiles again, and then we'll build from there.
Mm-hmm.
But the ones that are here, and they can do this real quick, how are we going to
Okay, they're not doing this real quick. They're doing this real quick because they have memorized.
But there are some students that do.
Can move through that.
Yeah.
True.
So if we don't think there are students there, then we're doing a disservice.
Mm-hmm.
So.
But you have to assess whether they have a conceptual understanding. And usually you're going to do that through them writing out their understanding or your questioning so that they're verbally explaining
and
it.
And that's what I'm getting to right there. It's like,
yes.
So how are we going to differentiate from that point to where this student's just doing stuff 5 times, 6 times, just like I said with
extending it instead
yes,
of just,
yes.
giving him
just
adding on.
Yes.
I just had this conversation yesterday with my leadership team.
We have a rule in MIX that we came up with accidentally, and I think you know the story. Dr. Browning and I were in a math class in actually Northeast School District in an 8th grade Algebra 1 class. And there was a table with two little girls and a little boy, and they had the whiteboard, and they were supposed to be working on it, and they were not. And so Dr. Browning went over and said, talked to the little boy and talked to the little girls, and it was obvious the little girls had no clue, and the little boy knew exactly what was going on, and he was just being obediently quiet. And so she told him, she said, okay, you have a job, and your job is to help these, your partners here understand that you can only ask questions. And for to be able to ask questions, you have to have a deep understanding
mm-hmm.
of it. And so in terms of differentiating, you're developed by doing, using that particular strategy, that student, the one who knows it, is developing a deeper understanding because they can only ask questions. It's easy to tell. It's hard to ask questions.
And I think that's great, but as the, our teachers are planning, they need to, well, the more experiences they get, they can pull the tool out of their back pocket real quick.
Yes.
They see something going on.
Right.
But I think what we're seeing here, or I see it quite a bit, is teachers as robots. Like, they get something like this, or like the Vibe or whatever, like, and you even said, we need to have some flexibility. Understand that this is something, this is your base recipe. Now let's add a little more salt to taste for some kids.
Exactly.
And so,
yeah, especially the
same. It's when you guys are teaching it, just they need to look for opportunities for differentiation, and that's what we're finding. So we're focusing on that a lot throughout.
So Denise, are you writing this down for Dr. Browning? Because she's going to be here, going to be doing the major portion of the instruction for the 23rd. Is that right? Yeah.
Yes, and I'm going to
October 23rd.
Pull that clip too. The other part of this discussion that I wanted to have, because I've thought about this since we were together last time. You know, the phrase is, a rising tide floats all boats.
Yeah.
I'm finding that when we talk about differentiation, if we talk about, okay, we have a baseline or we have a middle, then we never get to the extended. So I see much better experiences for kids and much better cognitive teaching, like much better teaching going on if the teacher is like, no, this is our overarching question. I'm working with everybody, but I'm really trying to hit the interest level of the top ones. I want them inspired. I want them empowered. I want the kid that already knows it that can deepen their understanding by asking those questions. So I start there. And then I pull, you know, little John over here who can't read, sits beside me, and I do the that kind of thing there. And then the ones that, you know, Tom is asking the questions of, they're getting it too. So the differentiation happens in how you manipulate that.
Right.
But everybody believes they're going to be like, they get to launch the rocket. You know?
And I think that's a good approach too, because what I've seen, like when we start talking about differentiation, this was at my last campus too, it was always watering it down, going for the low, nothing ever for the top. So
mm-hmm.
I think if we reframe it, that may be the way to go, start way up here and then. But just talking to the teachers about your example of grouping students intentionally and then giving them parameters on how they can speak
mm-hmm.
when they're in the group sometimes. And it's going to look different each time, but
mm-hmm.
the more examples they hear and the more people they hear it from, the more likely it's going to actually occur. Because right now, if we walk around, you're going to start seeing a little sprinkling of differentiation, but mostly everything, whole group instruction.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's working on the same,
mm-hmm.
at the same.
That's not the mixed model.
I understand.
Right, but that's what you're seeing.
Yes.
So that's your baseline.
Yeah,
that's
to,
I mean, we even created that form. I mean, going through there.
You know,
and that's not what they see with Browning
mm-hmm.
and teaching math. I mean, you've been there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
but I think it's also, though, you know, that I think they know it, but putting it into practice. And I think a lot of teachers, when they hear differentiation, they're thinking of their low kids.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not thinking about, I mean, it's just automatic.
Oh, yeah.
And that's where their mind goes to. And, you know, and I mean, just let's be real with accountability and stuff. We need to be pushing our level three kids more than ever. So why is it that we're not differentiating for all? You know, that we should be, and it should be clearly in your lesson plan. Okay, you know, for my high kids, this is what the extension is going to be, and it's not going to be an extra assignment, because that's what they do. That's what people say. Pre-AP, they get extra stuff to do, and that's not
what it is.
Here's
an extra worksheet. You get more questions on your
worksheet. Yeah, and that's not what it is. It's the quality of it, not the quantity.
So if it takes 170 hours, contact hours for us with our teachers before we see significant change, what does that mean for teachers learning differentiation and applying it, and what does that mean for kids as they're learning? You know, a lot of times teachers say, well, I taught that. They should know it. Well, if you mentioned it one time, do you get stuff one time? No. Yeah. So anyway, that's just, as administrators, that's one of the challenges that we are facing. Probably, and then how many times do we have to model for our teachers what we want to see them do?
So I love what you said about this is a model, and you put it up there, or some other model, but they're not so rigid.
Exactly.
And so as long as teachers keep hearing, so if it takes you 170 hours, it's going to take us 170 hours, and if we're speaking similar type languages, you know, so I'm expecting the bulk of the gains to happen, unfortunately, next year. This is just setting the table.
Absolutely.
Right. So, and then, so then as an administrator, what are you going to look for so that you know you are making incremental progress? Are they trying new things? Are you seeing it happen more often? Like, how are we measuring that?
Well, I think
so
it's also,
we know we're doing what we're supposed
to do. It's a change cycle. So that would be, okay, we're going to, in a PLC or in a faculty meeting or a PD day, you know, train them on differentiating, you know, for all levels and what we're going to expect to see. And then you say, okay, over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be looking for these things in your classroom and your lesson plans and those things, providing that feedback if they are or not doing it. And then saying, okay, did we do this? Did we not? And then continue, because that's what you have to do, because if we're not having those conversations once we set that expectation, but we also have to provide them with the information to do it.
And I would be wary of doing it on one day of training and then expecting to go in and see it. So some of the things we're doing, like even our meetings now, we're modeling it to the teachers and then just starting to introduce it, and over, let's just say, over the next 4 weeks, then in our PLC, bring in a lesson, you know, then we're going to help you figure out how to differentiate an activity, then we're going to go in, film you, then we're going to talk, and then just keep doing that, rather than, because what happens, you have a PD, and then this is the expectation. They know the expectation, but
I see what you're saying. But no, I'm including all of that too, but just we have to do it. But it's our job to go in and provide that feedback, and our ICs to go in and help provide that feedback. Because if we, even doing it and providing those, if we're not in there and providing that feedback, they're just going to go, oh, that's just another thing I have to do, and I'm not really going to do it.
And so we got pushback. They were here for the day. We feel like this is just another thing. And I kind of like, no, that this is stuff that you should have been working on as part of a lesson plan when you went to college.
Exactly.
And they're telling you to write a lesson, and then Dr. Kern said it perfectly later. It's just called teach.
Yes.
It says teach. I mean, let's just simplify it.
It's nothing more.
Teach.
Yep.
But it's, you know, I think we have expectations of teachers that are not realistic because they have not been trained. I mean, how many know instructional models besides my students?
So
how many of your teachers that come in actually know anything about selecting an instructional model? When do they get it in your PD?
So now I'm even just watching this and I'm thinking, and Ashley and I have been talking, like, did we jump ahead? We assumed maybe too much already, and we might have to even back up and sprinkle in differentiation, but also start going back to more of the fundamentals and layer in the differentiation.
This is a football.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because we were thinking like, all right, well, let's bring it down to these four things, and we think we might even have to go more.
Well, that's actually the crux of what I'm trying to say. When I go into a classroom and I see students not learning, because I'm walking around, I'm not just staying in the back of the room, and I'm watching their work, I'm maybe even asking them questions, and of course knowing the content is really important to be able to do that, but when I see that they're not learning, too many of them are not learning, I just go back to best practices. Did the students have, not today, you know, it could have been yesterday, did they have that concrete experience to develop the conceptual understanding that they need? Did they move then to a pictorial representational? And so if you look at your chart, pictorial representational is somebody else's work. In science, concrete is a student's work. In pictorial representational, it's not me graphing my data, it's looking at somebody else's graph of data. It could be in a textbook, it could be on a slide, it could be on a screen, you know, an iPad, doesn't make any difference. It is not mine. I have not wrestled with that. So that it becomes one step removed, and we often see instruction starting here. We are not seeing the 40% hands-on that's required in grades 6 through 12. The national recommendation for elementary is 80%, 60% for middle school, and 40% for high school to be able to understand concepts. That much hands-on investigation. Not hands-on, take that word out. Investigations. Hands-on are not necessarily investigations. They can be, but they're not synonymous. And then moving to the abstract, so you do get to the vocabulary, but you've heard me say you do not start with vocabulary in science and math, and I see that constantly.
We see that too, and so I'm so glad we have Candace that is helping push that. Mm-hmm.
And quite frankly, I'm a reading specialist. We were taught to teach vocabulary. What is lacking in that conversation is you don't pre-teach the vocabulary unless you've got
no context,
because they have nothing to tie it to. So you have to do it while they're reading, and then when they struggle with the word, then you let them struggle with it, and then when they figure that out, then you say, I wonder what that means. And then you do that, but you don't start first and say, you know.
Right. I walked into a classroom in an English class, like it was the first week or second week, and I'm like, what are you doing? We're writing vocab words for what? We have a test on Friday. Well, what's the test for? For vocab. Well, why? So I can pass the test. And it was just that I knew. So I just, and I kept saying these questions so the teacher would pick up, like, why are you doing this? So then we had the conversation, and it's like, this should be embedded. So then I actually brought over the content coordinator and said, hey, how would you do the vocab? He said, I would have them read the passage and circle the words they may not understand, or, you know, do something, then teach it within the context. So it's across, it's not just math, science.
I know, it's everywhere.
It's not a good practice.
Right, but
anyway.
I don't say what you should do in the LA
I
or those other disciplines.
And what's scary, so you say you go in and you're observing it, students are learning or not. Well, here, they're going to trick you because the kids are pretty compliant and the stuff is so easy that they look like they're learning. Shoot, some of these kids may have already known this stuff.
They're not learning, though. When I was in your classroom and I'm talking to your students last time we were here, I'm talking to these two little girls, they had absolutely no clue
about
what they were doing.
There's more that have a clue than what they're doing than typically.
Absolutely.
It's just not at the level that it.
That's the thing.
What's
the demographics at Dahlstrom, the kids can come in and really can do what they can make it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are a few, but we should, like you're saying, I feel, is that we could be pushing them so much farther and more.
And but you're right.
But not if they don't have the foundation. I mean, there are too many kids that do not have that foundation to build on. They're just memorizing stuff. They don't have the cognitive.
That's what I'm saying.
You know,
they're kind of tricking. And the teachers aren't explaining, like, the why we're going to learn this. There are some. I mean, like that one little girl I showed you the video of, she.
She got it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you know it can be done.
Yeah, and so, but I'm just saying, sometimes it's, you get fooled, and I think they've been fooled here for about 10 years.
And I keep hearing the word extension.
That should just be the baseline is what
exactly.
I'm hearing you say.
Exactly.
Forget
we're
extension.
We're not extending, we're teaching. We're teaching, and it starts high.
And
it
I may use
like,
that frame of mind and say like.
I think you have to be careful though, because we'll use jargon that teachers are not gonna understand, and if we're not clear with what that word means, you know, what it looks like in the classroom, what it sounds like in the classroom, that you're gonna have teachers trying to do one more thing, because that's how they're gonna view it, because they don't understand it. The next thing that I see when students are not learning is we don't start with the known. We start with the unknown. Now, we want to move them to the unknown. That's what education is about. But we need to start with the known. In fact, when I was looking at your landscape out there, one of the things that I was looking for was native plants, because that's going to bring in native critters, if you would. And that's what would be known. I was at a high school observation one semester, and this teacher was teaching about succession. It was a PowerPoint lecture. Even I was bored with it. And so the kids didn't understand it when she got through, so I took the student teacher outside, and I said, what do you see here? What, can you make some observations about this particular site right here? I was trying to be specific in that with her. And the answer I wanted her to get to, which she got to, was there were weeds in the flower bed. That's succession. So why not take the kids outside and use what's known and actually landscape your building so that you can do that, which, you know, some people do, and use that for the known. Why aren't they going outside and looking for erosion at elementary and middle school? There's plenty of examples outside. There's lots of science and math that's outside that is real world, the student's real world, not the adult real world, and what is known. So start with the known and then move them to the unknown. Why are we starting with a rainforest? You know, why not start with what's your prairie area here, which is kind of on the edge of two things, but that's all right. Anyway, but you know, start with the known, and then one concept or skill per lesson. So again, when I go in and I see students not learning, I see too many concepts in one lesson. You've got to scaffold it. I mean, they know that term, but what does it mean in their classrooms? I'm not seeing that. I'm seeing them trying to jumble all this stuff together, and the kids are trying to figure out, well, what do I learn now and when, and how do I use it later? I mean, they're just confused. That's one of the problems, as I said, is the one skill or concept per lesson. So it might be, if you go back to the graphic that I showed you, so it might be, for example, teaching them how to use a microscope before they look at cells and start looking at characteristics of cells. So the direct instruction for teaching them how to use a microscope is what I'm calling a lesson before they get to learning about characteristics of cells and whether they're, you know, prokaryotes or eukaryotes or whatever. So the idea that you've got several lessons within a period, depending on what your learning objective is. And to step back and look at that, and oftentimes, again, I see a lot of instructional time wasted. I don't know about y'all, but I do. And it has to do with a lack of procedures, and it has to do with a lack of planning. You're not deeply planning things.
Can I throw something in here, too? As an administrator, how many of you are science and math? Like, that's your content area. Okay.
But it's just been a long time.
Okay.
I mean, with everything else that we bring on, you become less of an expert and just
So we're in the administrative mode, and we're supposed to be instructional leaders for doing all of this. And I don't know about
all
you, but there was a couple of things that she just now said. I've never even heard those words. And I don't, so I learn from her, and I have, as an administrator, I have to be able to model the instructional best practices for my teachers because they don't see it. So how do I model it? And I'm not the content expert.
I think I'd be videotaping Candace or, you know, some of your teachers that you're seeing that and showing just the clips. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a big fan of videotaping teachers for somebody else to see. I'm a big fan of teachers taping themselves, and they're looking for what best practices are students learning, what's the evidence for it, what do you think is missing if they're not learning.
Mm-hmm.
so that they're doing the analysis of it rather than me doing that for them. And that's what I do with my student teachers. When we debrief, I say, what worked in the lesson? Those are things. Then you tell me what didn't work, and why do you think it didn't work? What best practices were missing? So they've got the choices, you know, and my job is to get them to be self-sufficient. They're not going to have me around after.
And the
semester.
Teachers helps with that, just the model of the refinement, the reinforcement. Yeah.
So that actually, I mean, I'm thinking about as an administrator, and I'm not the content expert, how do I ask questions in such a way that I am confident that the teacher is a content expert? So what you just did was do that. The other part of the videoing, when the teacher is videoing themselves and having to pull the clip and having to analyze that, what part of concrete pictorial abstract is that?
It's concrete. They're doing it themselves.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So if they're doing it themselves, that's a concrete experience for them. If they're watching somebody else do it, analyze it, etc., it's one step away from their own experience. So it's no longer a concrete experience for them.
So if you're modeling as an administrator in your PD, and you have a clip that the teacher has already done, like Candace,
yeah.
Okay, that's a process. That's part of the experience. So you're going to show the process as part of the direct instruction piece, and then you tie that in. But then the teachers have to have time to do that right then. Mess with it, you know, figure it out. You get 10 seconds, we need the clip, whatever. And that's going to be something that you can't just talk about it. They have to mess with it and figure it out. And then you'll figure out, too, that you don't have a place to store the videos, that you don't have a clear process there. So you learn together, yeah. Anyway, but that's a big deal.
Also, I don't have it on this slide, so if you use these, here's an edit I would suggest that you make. This can be used either in direct instruction or in inquiry. It's true no matter which one you